a cobalt blue stain on the map that hung on the wall of the classroom in the old schools. A stain that began to get smaller, 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 until one day it was just the shadow of what it had been. I wondered what had happened to the Aral Sea, with the beaches, with the fish, with the seagulls, the lovers who had strolled beside it, the sunsets, the children who had learned to swim, defying the waves. The sound of the same breaking against the pier. And needless to say, the fishermen, the canneries, the fish markets, the harbours, the boats, the life that is born in the sea and lives off it, the smell of saltpeter and tar. We left in search of the Aral shore, or what was left of it. Years ago, two rivers, the Amu Darya and the Daria, which ran into the Aral Sea after travelling over 2,000 kilometres, had their courses altered to irrigate enormous fields of cotton. But the pipes were laid too quickly and using defect materials, which led to 70% of their water volume being lost. During decades, the sea scarcely received any water and it began to evaporate rapidly. Today, its size is less than half of what it was 30 years ago, and the water level has decreased by 75%. The chemical fertilizers used to speed up cotton growth have converted this area into one of the most polluted on Earth. The levels of illness and deformities, as well as rates of infant mortality and lymphatic cancer, are amongst the highest on the continent. And of course, nobody wants cotton anymore. The memorial was erected last year for the purpose of holding an international symposium to raise funds and generate ideas about how to remedy what some people regard as the worst environmental catastrophe of all time. Those taking part in the symposium furnished statistics about the salinity of the water, which had tripled and caused the total destruction of its flora and fauna. Some spoke about the layer of chemical pesticides that, as the water level goes down, are blown by the wind in the form of harmful dust storms that seriously affect the region's inhabitants' health.
The name of the boat is Seagull. I started working here after I finished 10th grade. In the 10th grade, they taught us all how to sail.
The secret laboratories that the Soviets had installed on the islands of Aral, that stopped being islands when the seas dried up, were abandoned without carrying out the proper security measures, and a multitude of viruses were let loose in the air.
Now people are planting these bushes so that the wind doesn't blow the sand away. 40 kilometers from here are the bigger boats.
The climate has been drastically affected. Temperatures have become extreme. And this is a crucial point that turns out to be perversely controversial. The present authorities are endeavoring to put all the area's misfortunes down to global climate change.
We never could have imagined it. After 1975, if one day you bathed here, the next day you'd have to bathe a little further over there. The sea disappeared quickly. One time I came here with my son to tell him about my memories of the sea. It was as if I was telling a story. I was over there, and my son was behind me. He didn't know I could see him. I saw his shadow and noticed he was pointing his finger to his ear, as if to say he's crazy. To him, it sounded like a fairy tale. He thought I was crazy. Completely crazy. I miss it, and I hope it will come back soon. There's an old legend that says the Aral has dried three times. Three times it's dried, and three times it's come back. Three times. Someday the sea will come back.
They want to rewrite recent history and erase the decrees that knowingly have destroyed the Aral Sea. But the sea's memory is more stubborn than all of history's interpretations. What did the inhabitants of Moynak think when the sea was getting smaller? What do they think now, when they see the dusty photos in the museum, the old fishing nets, the watercolors of boats and sunsets? How is it possible to be born beside the sea and one fine day lose it? The Moynak Museum is the sole eyewitness left in this place today that only two generations ago was a coastal city.
I worked in the factory for 45 years, from 1948 to 1991. We used to send our canned fish to many countries all over the world. We sent our canned fish to Czechoslovakia and various Soviet Union countries. And we sent it to other countries too, like Spain. Compared with those from other seas, the fishes here were very big and very tasty. It's because they ate the grass on the seabed. That's why they were so tasty. At home, we would eat fish 3 times a day. That's why I'm so strong, even today. In a fist fight, I could beat any young man. I could beat them all.
Six 600 people worked in this factory, handling thousands of tons of fish. In the mid-60s, canned fish was sent out from here to all parts of the Soviet Union. 10 years later, when one went to the beach and noticed on returning the next day that the sea had moved back a meter, and the following, a couple more, and so on, until the sea was no more than a sigh on the horizon. The factory had to close down.
I was never a fisherman. But all my neighbors were fishermen. And because there were so many fishermen, back then there wasn't so much demand. Every day, they'd hand me a bucket full of fish. In the end, I had to start telling them not to give me any more. The water will return. That's why we shouldn't question why these boats are still here.
across this hard country in disbelief. Anyone not knowing the history of this area would swear that this dry and hostile valley had been a sea full of life, abundant with pike, carp, sturgeon, and algae, that on this bed of land rested millions of tons of water where boats sailed, where seagulls fished. A journey of 300 kilometers for a mirage of waves and tides. From time to time, we find strange rows of dry bushes, the only evidence of attempts made to prevent the area from ending up as a total desert. But we fear that this is no more than a drop in the ocean. Till we got back to and held on to that moment in the sun. Carry it with you, child, I'll be there. Dreams of two. Hold you every night. I stroke your hair. I'll make it right. Be there with you on any day you want me. I'll hold your dream. I'll get your jokes. Try to tell some too. While remaining in front of what is left of this sea, I think of one of Wisława Szymborska's poems. Some fishermen dragged a bottle from the seabed. There was a piece of paper in the bottle, and on that paper were written these words: "Help, I am here. The ocean threw me onto a desert island. I am on the shore, waiting for help. Make haste, I'm here." There is no date, it's probably too late. "The bottle could have been floating a long time," said the first fisherman. "And no place mapped, we don't even know which ocean it refers to," said the second fisherman. "Neither too late nor too far. The here island is everywhere," said the third fisherman. An uncomfortable silence reigned. That is the trouble with truths.
It's all over. In Kazakhstan, the sea is alive. It's okay. The people can fish again in Kazakhstan. But here, it's all gone. It's all over. Thank you.
Thank you.